Georgia. And here comes the entire team. I can't believe this.
This was absolutely planned.
Blitz coming. Tebow is sacked. He's been sacked 5 times in this game. 6 times he's been down. Marino. Nice spin move. Marino comes left. Huge hole. Georgia touchdown.
There's the snap. He's in. Touchdown, Tim Tebow. Oh, my.
Stafford, right side, picked off, and here we go down the sideline. Joe Hayden.
Here's the response from Urban Meyer to last year. 49-10, and I'm calling every timeout, and I'm going to finish the game the way I want it.
It is a very, very warm and muggy day in Jacksonville, Florida. We welcome you to Jacksonville Municipal Stadium. Tim Tebow first saw this game as a 4-year-old. He doesn't remember it. His parents do. The Georgia Bulldogs flew in from Athens for this, a renewal of this rivalry game played here every year except 2 since the midst of the Great Depression. We welcome you to the Home Depot SEC on CBS. This afternoon, the Georgia Bulldogs, 4-3 for the year, winners in their last game against Vanderbilt. And here are the defending national champions, undefeated again, 7-0, the Gators of Florida. And behind them, the Bulldogs of Georgia and black helmets. Well, you knew it had to be something. Good afternoon, everybody. Vern Lundquist along with Gary Danielson and Tracy Wolfson. Happy Halloween. We've seen a couple of tricks in this game in the last 2 years, haven't we? First, the rushing the field by Georgia, the timeouts from Florida, and this afternoon, black helmets. Well, it's also a game of curious elements. Florida running in sand inside the 20 so far this year. They're undefeated, but some of their fan base, maybe some of the players, are acting like they're the team that's 4-3. Georgia's defense has been playing like it's a leaky old boat, and they are turning the ball over at a staggering rate. I was about to say, so far, Gary, no extraneous stuff.
Let's try to stay away from that for a few minutes. We got a lot of time, and let's go to the X's and O's. There's not a lot of mismatches I think Georgia has on the field, but I do think they have a path to victory. Let's start on defense. Their 3 defensive tackles can be game breakers in this football game. They can take away that Florida inside running game and allow that Georgia defense with a lot of speed to run down that option attack from Florida. And then on offense, you know, they want to run the ball, but I believe the only way they can is to establish A.J. Green. He can force Florida to put a safety over the top or a linebacker underneath and distort Florida's run defense. I think that allows the other 10 guys an opportunity to keep the pressure off Joe Cox. A.J. Green and the defensive tackles, I think, is the game plan.
Well, you talk about Florida, and their problems inside the 20 have been amazing, I think.
They really are. I mean, everybody's saying they're winning a lot of close games, and the reason they are is because they're turning the ball over, unlike Urban Meyer or even Florida players are used to. If they would have held on to the ball inside the 20, they would have 3 more blowouts. And the frustration is headed to a guy we've never seen frustrated in 4 years, Tim Tebow. Last week against Mississippi State, interceptions, pick six. That'll get anybody frustrated. But Tim Tebow in the spread is the guy that must make plays, and that inside of Georgia must force Tebow to get outside the pocket.
Well, for more on Tim Tebow, his final regular season college game here, let's go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Well, thanks, Vern. Tim Tebow could make history today. He has a chance to break former Georgia running back Herschel Walker's record for most career rushing touchdowns in the SEC. He tied it last week at 49 against Mississippi State, but he told us to break it in his hometown of Jacksonville against Georgia, no less, would be extra special.
Getting to know him as a person and getting to see him play as a fan of his was very special. And to be mentioned and tied with Herschel Walker, you know, it's incredible. And when you look back, it's very humbling. And, you know, it's exciting that I get an opportunity now in tying him to go play Georgia and Jacksonville. I think it's all pretty cool.
Guys, you can bet this is extra motivation for Georgia. Also, they certainly do not want Tebow to break the record against them today.
I would think not, Trace. This game and all SEC college football games brought to you in crystal clear CBS high definition. It is hot, really hot. 86 degrees, winds out of the south, and this could be the highest temperature we've ever had for this rivalry game. Florida leads the series. It's the 77th all-time meeting in Jacksonville. And the last game here, 49-10, largest Georgia loss since Mark Richt became the head coach. Georgia won the toss. They have deferred the option. And there you go with the black helmets, the black slacks, and Blair Walsh ready to kick off to Brandon James. One kickoff return for a touchdown this year. See the average of touchbacks to kickoffs, pretty impressive this year. And this could be another one. That's his 10th touchback of the season. And so the Gators will open play offensively from their own 20-yard line. Tim Tebow, 65% for the year. These are for the career. And 49 rushing TDs. Tracy just highlighted that potential record-breaking opportunity this afternoon. This is the first time in the long history of the Georgia Bulldogs they have ever worn the black helmets. I'm betting somewhere Dan McGill and Lauren Smith gave us that information along with Claude Felton. First down and 10. David Nelson in motion. This is Demps. Oh, he's got the corner turn. And he is out to the 27-yard line. Let's introduce you to the starting lineups presented by Chick-fil-A. And a switch up front. Johnson, Pouncey, Maurice Hurd at right tackle, and Marcus Gilbert at the right guard. It's Deontay Thompson, David Nelson, the wideouts, Aaron Hernandez, the tight end, Riley Cooper, and Demps opened in the backfield. Urban Meyer with a gaudy record as the head coach. Tebow fires it out, caught by Nelson. And David Nelson becomes only the third member. And he gets the catch. Take a look.
David Nelson came on real strong last year for Florida and has kind of disappeared this year. It wasn't a great throw by Tebow, but I think it shows that the tweak, if you want to call that, for Florida, one of them is get more players involved on the Florida offense.
Now Chris Rainey is in the backfield. That was Nelson's 9th catch of the year. And here's Tebow. He's got the corner turn. One-on-one. And he steps out of bounds with a 9-yard gain at the 49-yard line. Brandon Boykin, number 2, is there to force him out of bounds.
Well, 2 years ago, Tebow came into this game with a wounded shoulder. This year, he comes in with a little bit of wounded pride. Now, this Georgia defense has must stop the run, but you can see already that Florida is trying to give them more to the outside and not that dive play that they started the year off so much with. Stay away from those big tackles.
Yes. Here's Brandon James in the slot. Tebow, play fake. Shovel pass, caught, first down.
Uh-oh.
Is it Brandon James?
Uh-oh.
We got a flag.
Again, another touch from a player that hasn't been getting the ball a lot in the offense. Tebow looks downfield and drops it off to James. So Nelson, James, different players. And then as the player was right on the sideline.
Personal foul, number 50. Defense waving it out of bounds. First down, 10.
Tom Ritter, excuse me, Gary.
Yeah, I don't know if it was face mask burn or out of bounds hit. Either one, it was clearly a penalty. Could have been either, huh?
Yeah, I thought it was face mask. They rule a late hit. Tom Ritter, as we saw graphically, is our referee today. And Georgia averaging 75 yards per game with penalties. Here's Tebow, one-on-one on the corner. Brandon Wood, number 47, in isolation with Tebow. And let's introduce you to the Bulldog starting defense. Houston, Owens and Atkins, along with Cade Weston McKee in the interior defensive line. Nick Williams gets the start for Dewberry today, along with Gamble and Rennie Curran. And in the secondary, it's Miller, Jones, Evans, and Brandon Boykin. Now they're about to get inside the 20, and we'll watch, see if there's anything new. Steve Adazio telling us on the phone, you might see some I formation. Here's a play fake. Tebow goes deep. He's got a man in the end zone. Cooper, touchdown. Tim Tebow said after the game in Moa, Mississippi State last week, he and Brandon Spikes asked to talk to the team. They won it, but they didn't seem convinced it was a very impressive victory. Tebow said, I talked to him emotionally. It was kind of this year's Ole Miss moment.
Yeah, you know, Vern, 2 weeks ago, Tennessee drove Georgia fits with misdirection. Watch Boykin right here and watch the misdirection boot. Riley Cooper at the end of the line of scrimmage. Brandon Boykin bites on the misdirection boot play. Obviously, Florida has seen the Tennessee game tapes.
Well, Riley Cooper, that's roommate to roommate, as we mentioned over the years. Urban Meyer says, we've seen your black hats. We'll raise you one. LG, as a proud NCAA corporate partner, invites you to celebrate game day moments in the SEC.
Go Gators!
Go Dogs!
Let's go Eagles!
Happy Halloween!
Go Dogs!
Go Dogs!
Go Gators!
No, go Dogs!
Ah, that's it.
That's worth it. That's
great,
worth
absolutely. Well, as you can tell, life is good in the SEC. Riley Cooper, 22 yards, 39-1 record, and that is the first time, as a footnote, they've scored a touchdown in the opening drive since Charleston Southern.
Wow. Does that count, Charleston Southern? It does. They all count, but SEC is tough, much tougher.
Caleb Sturgis kicks off. Brandon Boykin with two 100-yard returns for touchdown this year. Will not have one on this play. Janoris Jenkins, the starting cornerback.
Boykin, a lot of speed, but he's going up a lot against a lot of speed, and that was almost a decapitation. At least the helmet came off.
Joe Cox waited all of his career to be a starter at Georgia. Backed up Matthew Stafford. And in this season, 1,581 yards. The interceptions have been a problem. He has thrown at least one in each of the seven games. Handoff, right side. It's Rayshon Ely. the freshman who is getting his second consecutive start. Georgia offense with Cox at quarterback. This is a switched up line.
Yeah, Bowling going to left tackle. That's the fourth different left tackle Georgia has used this year.
See, Ely getting his second start. A.J. Green, number 8. And Tavares King are the wideouts. High formation. Here's the toss sweep, right side. Ely breaks through out across the 25 to the 27. Well, the Gators, once again, they yielded this position for 1 week. They are back at number one defensively, statistically, in Division I. Tratto, Dunlap, and Cunningham. Brandon Spikes is back. He's essentially missed 2.5 games. Ryan Stamper playing at home. And the secondary, Jenkins, Black, Wright, Will Hill, and Joe Hayden. They go 3-3-5 for the most part. Charlie Strong, defensive coordinator. Now they go 4 down. Omar Hunter comes on. Here's a flag thrown before the play got underway. And a little wrestling match breaks up. Urban Myers out on the 27-yard line.
I think Orson Charles, number 7, flinched before the snap.
Take a look at it. Orson Charles. Watch number 51, Brandon Spikes. Oh!
False start. Number 7. Offense, 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Well, it's not as dramatic as the last time we were here when he put a hit on number 24 to start last year's game. Remember that one?
Oh, that's. Watch this. Brandon Spikes on Noshon Marino. Another look. As long as I've been doing this, Gary, I think that's one of the most impactful defensive plays to open a game I've ever seen. And I'm sure Marino's watching now with the Denver Broncos and not having pleasant memories of that moment. Cox got it. And it's Ely out of the backfield. Big play, 20-yard gain.
Well, he absolutely went to the right player. Florida was giving him a late defense double zone. He went right down the middle. He matched up against a linebacker inside, and he was able to do it perfectly. That was Duke Lemons, actually a defensive end, who had to run with Ely on that play. Perfect read by Joe Cox.
Joe Cox happy. So was Ely, showing some elation. It was his first catch of the season. Good for 20 and a first down. High formation. Ely breaks the tackle, nears the 50. Ahmad Black with the stop after a 7-yard gain.
Well, you know, when Georgia switches around their offensive line, they're expecting better blocking up front. Josh Davis, number 78, is in a right tackle now for Bowling, and they run the toss play right at Josh Davis.
Gain of 7 yards, second down and 3.
Ely got to start last week for the first time in the win against Vanderbilt. 71 yards in that one. Here's Dunlap, who limps off.
When do they get the ball to A.J. Green?
He's got 41 catches this year, but he has been about it offensively. And Cox having trouble finding him. Hand off up the middle to Richard Samuel, who started the first 6 games of the year. This has been a non-productive running offense, averaging 108 yards per game. And another flag.
Richard Samuel, ball carrier. Tackle made by number 92, Terrence Sanders.
...75 yards per game average for Georgia. Mark Richt taught this earlier in the year. He said, you know, when I was at Florida State, and he was there for more than a decade, we led the ACC in penalty yardage every year.
Dead ball.
Didn't
personal
seem to hurt.
Foul, number 78. Offense, unnecessary roughness after the play. 15-yard penalty, third down.
And I don't want to hear any griping about this one. Josh Davis rips the helmet off of the Florida player. Top of your screen right there. Watch this. That's just a lack of discipline, and that's going to over spikes. That's spikes. See, and that's a call you just can't have. I mean, you can talk about reputations for having a lot of penalties all you want, but that is just way too obvious. Right. Anyone can call that.
Now a little conference going on. A.J. Jones and Brandon Spikes. Now Spikes, groin pull, and he didn't play at all last week.
Charlie Strong told us he could have played last week if I needed him, but he really wanted him to set out another game.
Third and 15. Florida's, well, they're not bringing five. They're laying off. And that's going to go nowhere as Ryan Stamper, number 41, who's playing before a hometown crowd here. Jacksonville native, it'll be fourth down.
If I was going to put a word on the Georgia team, I would use the word transition this year. I mean, there's no way last year with Matthew Stafford on third and 15, they're not chucking the ball.
Right.
I mean, this is just a different team. And right now, Mark Richt and Mike Bobo just do not want to put it into Joe Cox's hands early in this game on third and long.
Drew Butler leads the division in punting. You see that 49.4 yard average, and Brandon James, who has been hampered this year, he's only got a 3.5 average. Well, as Gary pointed out a couple of weeks ago, it's because they're not kicking to him. And this time they try and send him back.
Perfect.
He'll let it go.
Yep. Perfect.
Yep. Drew Butler, who is the son of Kevin Butler, All-American kicker at Georgia in the early 80s on the Herschel teams. Nice punt. 7-0 Florida leads. Very impressive opening drive of the game. Seven nothing Florida. They scored on the opening drive, and it was an impressive one, Gary.
It really was, and I think when we brought up the fact that Georgia's stout inside, Florida adjusted and said, you know what, we're going to start this game running the edges and booting the edges and force a little space inside later in the game. Two sweeps, two bootlegs, and of course the bootleg pass for the touchdown. You can tell that they saw this game tape and said misdirection wide is the way to start the game.
And on first down, Jeff Demps is alongside. Now so also is Brandon James. Here's the first test up the middle. It gets a couple. Rennie Curran, number 35, the leading tackler on the Georgia team. And let's spend a moment with Tim Brando in New York.
Vern, the first game at UConn since the tragic passing of Jasper Howard, and with under a minute left, UConn had scored on a fourth down play, and then Tom Savage's 81-yard pass to Tim Brown for Rutgers with 22 ticks left would be the difference maker. Rutgers wins it 28-24. Back to you.
Okay, Tim, thank you. It's 7-0 here midway through the first. It's second down and 8 officially. Play fake. Tebow sidearms it to a man out wide right. It's Deontay Thompson, number 6. And that's a first down. Last play.
When the quarterback, Vern, starts getting outside of the pocket, the defense will adjust. Watch Nick Williams, number 39, take Tebow out well after the handoff. Well after the handoff.
First and 10 for Florida at the real 19-yard line.
You know, that type of stuff will come back later in the game. Someone will see it later.
You bet.
And that's why you're almost last in the country in penalties.
First down and 10 on the completed pass to Thompson. This one right side again. Down low is Riley Cooper with his second catch. Cooper with the touchdown grab of 22 yards. On the opening drive. 7 to go in the first quarter.
You know what else is popping out here is it looks like that no huddle offense that Florida tried to steal from Oklahoma.
Mm-hmm.
They canned that. And I never liked it. And the reason was Tebow is such a great leader. I want him looking at my offensive lineman every snap.
Second down. Tebow, a perfect start, 5 for 5. Here's the dive play up the middle. Emmanuel Moody, who is the third running back. Young man from North Central Texas, started his career at Southern California and then came to Florida as a transfer.
Well, when you talk to the Florida coaches, they say Moody has earned his touches.
Had some fumble problems early. Coppell, Texas, a little bit north of the Dallas-Fort Worth Regional Airport, International Airport. I can't call it the Regional Airport. I'll get letters. First down. Rainey split off wide right. Four-man rush. They're stunning. Here's a quick screen out to Deontay Thompson, and he's got some room down the sidelines. Out to the 45, and this just might be enough to move the chain again.
Well, you tell me, on the start of this game, if you're a Georgia fan watching your team play defense, or a Florida fan, that this doesn't remind you more of the 2008 of attack than so far we've seen in 2009. Everything in 2009 has started off up the middle with the option. Now it looks more like the spread.
Now here's Rainey alongside Tim Tebow. Play fake again. Tebow's been perfect so far, wide open, and it's dropped by Brandon James. Oofta.
Yeah, it was a poorly thrown ball by Tebow and a worse catch.
Yeah.
Absolutely looking right in the sun, though, Brandon James was, and he fought it all the way, didn't he? See the shadow going exactly away from it? But a poorly thrown pass by Tim Tebow with a guy 25 yards in the open.
First incompletion of the game for Tebow. It's second down and 10.
Another misdirection boot.
Play fake. Caught. Went right through the arms of Darryl Gamble and Aaron Hernandez, the tight end. Makes the catch. Third and 5. 7 of 8 for Tebow, 77 yards. Talked about the aftermath of the Mississippi State game. For the first time in his career at Georgia, Tebow did not meet with members of the media. Did spend some time talking with his former offensive coordinator, Dan Mullen, and his family. And then apologized on Monday, but said, I hope everybody understands. Here's Tebow, and it's a first down.
Third and 5. Florida has been having problems pass blocking in this situation. No one to throw to. Kind of goes right through Kern on this one. Reggie Kern does a nice job taking away the first throw and then can't handle Tim. Oh, look at that. He even tried to trip him on that one and didn't do it. When's the last time we've seen Tebow try to finesse somebody in that situation?
Well, he needed 5 and he got 6. And Demps and Rainey are both alongside Tebow now. Here's the sweep to the left. Blocker down. And let's go back to the studio for this John Hancock update. Here's Tim.
Vern and Gary in the wild, wild west. Auburn is back. Two teams were going in different directions coming in. Here's Ben Tate, which would give Auburn a 31-7 lead. He has now over 1,000 yards on the season. They hung on to win it 33-20. Ole Miss drops to a paltry 2-3 in the SEC West, once ranked as high as number 4 in the country. Back to you.
And Alabama with an off week, LSU playing Tulane tonight. Ole Miss, one of the major disappointments of the year, I would think, with all the preseason hype. Here's Demps around the corner, another first down. Boy, they are really operating effectively. Well, Steve Adazio said we've become predictable.
Sure have. It's the wide zone play, and you will see Florida pull two offensive linemen to get out in front of Demps on this one. Just a total different look and a nice adjustment by Florida, who said to win the national championship, we have to do something more than just try to establish the dive play.
Well, we mentioned Dan Mullen, who is now the head coach at Mississippi State, and
Steve Addazio, a longtime colleague of Urban Meyer, started with him at Notre Dame and came here 5 years ago, is now the offensive coordinator. Here's Tebow. He's been really good here in the first quarter. And that one is gathered in. Touchdown, Riley Cooper. It is under review.
Now, Riley Cooper is a very physical receiver. I think he held off Boykin and caught this one one-handed. So it was a perfect throw. Let's watch it one-on-one. Nice head inside. Good coverage by Boykin. Holds him with his left hand. Catches it with his right hand. Yes, he did. Now, did he come down in time? The ball was not bobbled. He caught the ball. Look at that catch. Great coverage. He's got it. Right foot comes down. You know, look at this play, Vern, really. Boykin can't cover any better. Tebow can't throw it any better. And Riley Cooper can't catch it any better.
No. And certainly nothing there would seem to, you know, overturn the call.
You know what, the guys, I was listening to the guys on Sunday on the CBS thing, and I think it was Boomer who said, you can't defend a perfect pass. And this is exactly what this is, a perfect pass and a tremendous catch.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed, touchdown.
Steve Landis is our replay official, longtime SEC referee, and Tebow has his second touchdown toss to his roommate, Riley Cooper. Caleb Sturgis is on to try the extra point. Missed one against Mississippi State. Also missed a field goal, and Urban Meyer getting a little edgy about his position, but he is on there now. Said he might open up the kicking game again to Jonathan Phillips. Well, that's worth another look.
Well, Georgia tries to disguise here with two deep safeties. Watch this. Two deep safeties, one there. But at the snap, they move into man-to-man coverage. Florida, Tebow reads it properly, throws to the right guy. Not a lot of space, but if you put it up towards that back pylon, not much bad can happen.
Well, Tim Tebow's second toss to his roommate. This one, 29 yards. It's been all Gator. Watch Fantasy Football Today to get the last-minute news and analysis you need to set up your Fantasy League lineup live every Sunday at 11 a.m. Eastern, only on CBSSports.com. Well, already this year, Stephen Garcia of South Carolina, Ryan Mallett of Arkansas, Jonathan Crompton of Tennessee have had career days against this Georgia defense. Tebow's off to a pretty good start. He's 8 of 9 and thrown for 2.
Yeah, and right now Georgia's trying to find where Florida's going to attack next. They are totally off balance on defense.
Touchback. Now Caleb Sturgis is getting into the act. He's getting pumped. Remember how calm he was when he kicked that game winner against Arkansas?
Yes, he was. Well, I'll go back to what I think Georgia needs to do, and that's throw the ball towards number 8, A.J. Green. I just don't believe they're strong enough to run the ball consistently against this Florida defense. They must distort them a little bit with the pass to their best player, even if it's incomplete.
Florida will open defensively with 4 down. Stamper and Spikes, the linebackers, inside. Now here comes Spikes. Saw something and he came across the neutral zone. It's going to be another penalty against Georgia.
Yeah, Orson Charles again, number 7.
Start. Number 7. Offense, 5-yard penalty. Remains first down.
Left side of the screen, number 7. This is the second one. Top of the screen right here. I'm sorry. Center's calling out the plays, Ben Jones is, and Orson Charles thinks he hears the snap count.
Fourth penalty against the Bulldogs. Ely and Shoppus in the eye. Shoppus is the fullback. Here's the change from Joe Cox. Counter change from Brandon Spikes. Cox to throw, right side. On the cut, incomplete. Intended for Tavares King. A.J. Green, last week.
Well, last week, you know, Vanderbilt was a little nervous about covering A.J. Green at the line of scrimmage. It gave him space to throw plays like this. The difference for Florida is they will get up in his face and force Joe Cox to throw the ball downfield more to get it to him. They're not going to give him those gimmies. Watch. Jenkins and Hayden will get right in his face and force a deeper throw. There it is again. No gimmies early.
Cox in trouble. He'll run 20, 25 and out of bounds. Well, A.J. Green grew up in Somerville, South Carolina. Played for the Somerville Green Wave. And he played from the sixth grade on against Carlos Dunlap, the outstanding defensive end who played at Fort Dorchester High School, also in the Charleston area. Dunlap was telling a story earlier this week about how in their senior year, he got so frustrated at Green's ability to get open, he went from his defensive line position and went out to chuck him on the corner. Green gave him a hip and went for a touch. Here's Cox and Tavares King. And just as a footnote to that, fun to watch this stuff. Somerville won last night over Buford 30-33. John McKissick, the coach in high school, South Carolina, his 58th year.
58.
Won his 565th game last night. Gary, I don't want to date myself, but I'm going to. He started coaching in high school when I was in the sixth grade.
Wow.
Yeah. First down. Rayshon Ely. Let's go down to Tracy.
Well, guys, from the time he was a sophomore, A.J. Green had already verbally committed to Georgia. But in 2007, Urban Meyer was still trying to convince him to sign with the Gators. He went to Somerville High and reportedly asked him, is there anything I can say, any way I can convince you to at least come take a visit to Florida? A.J. just said, no, sir, I appreciate it, but I'm a Bulldog.
And he's a pretty good one. Wow. Second down.
It's very hot out there. You know, this is only a four-play drive here, and A.J. Green is already resting.
Up the middle, first down, Georgia. Richard Samuel, the ball carrier. That's the second first and 10, Gary.
I was impressed with Georgia's last first down when they rolled out of the pocket, knowing that blitz package or that nickel package of Florida is very troubling to pick up. Bobo dialed it correctly, and Joe Cox got him a first down, and now they inch out for another one.
...90 seconds remaining, opening quarter. Cox open, caught. First down, Georgia at the 44 of Florida. A.J. Green.
That's what you got to do. You're so afraid of this guy going deep that if you get him on these crossing routes against those aggressive linebackers from Florida, there's space in the middle, and Jenkins didn't handle him, and they didn't get the safety there in time.
Mike Bobo, second week in succession, he's been on the sidelines. The offensive coordinator went back down on the sidelines in the game at Vanderbilt, said he just wanted to feel the emotion and look his guys in the eye. First down and 10. Cox, right side, wide open. This is Rontavious Wooten, number 17. And it's another Georgia first down.
Well, Wooten ran what you call a speed out here against Jenkins. Watch, no, just bend it to the outside. Nice throw to the outside. Easy pitch and catch. Remember, Georgia was moving okay last time until they got the dead ball foul. So this is, they're feeling that they can move the ball if they just stop making penalties.
And again, a four down line defensive set. First down, 10 after that 18-yard pickup. Cox up the middle. It's Ely. Brandon Spike sans helmet.
Well, this is the second time Spikes has had his helmet on the ground. First time it was ripped off. This time it was knocked off.
Mm. Ouch. Yeah, he's down at the 15-yard line. Well, he's had an Achilles problem, a groin pull, and now a little ache to the head.
You know, when you leverage those hits like that as a linebacker or a football player and you leverage with all your might, sometimes you tweak that groin again. I don't know if it was he got a shot to the head or if it, he felt it in his groin again.
Told the story before about his meeting Tim Tebow at a recruiting visit to Alabama, and Brandon Spike said, I'm going where he's going. That's the end of the quarter. They wound up at Florida. That's the end of the first quarter with our score 14-0 Gators. We'll return to Jacksonville after this message and a word from your local station. It's right up there with Imagine by John Lennon, don't you? One of the great songs ever written.
Been there a while, huh?
Yeah, it has. This is Ugga the Seventh. And it's second down and 7. We began quarter number 2. Vern Lundquist, Gary Danielson, Tracy Wolfson, Georgia, Florida. High behind Joe Cox. Ely. Cut down. Well, we began talking this afternoon about the red zone inefficiency of Florida. They haven't needed to get into the red zone so far.
That's true. They're hot. I mean, Florida has 10 first downs, no penalties.
Right.
I mean, they had one drop ball. And I think this drive by Georgia, moving the ball and moving the chains, I mean, that's their hope. Keep that Florida defense a little off balance and take some time off the clock. Rest that defense who's having trouble with that Florida offense right now.
And so a third down of some significance here as we start the second quarter. Look at that. 4 touchdowns, 2 on the ground, 2 in the air.
Delay a game.
My goodness.
Was it 2nd and 6? And
yes.
Now it's going to be 3rd and 14.
Right, took a snap. Delay of game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still 3rd down.
You know, we all keep notes on these teams from the beginning of the summer. And so I was going back at the stuff from August regarding Georgia this week. And there was an article in the Athens newspaper from Mark Rick saying, we are going to address the penalty problem this year. Haven't done it. 3rd and 14. Cox with time. Deep down the middle.
Oh,
woefully underthrown. Tavarius King was at the goal line 3 yards behind the defenders.
4 different Gators were fighting over this interception. Try to throw the ball down the middle of the field and watch the Florida defense react to this football. Ball's in the air, and look at that. 4 Gators had a better shot at that than A.J. Green did.
Blair Walsh on. He's 11 of 12 for the year. High snap, just from 49. It's got plenty of distance, and it is perfect.
Well, successful drive.
Yes.
That's what they needed.
But Cox missed a wide open Tavarius King for the touchdown. Blair Walsh, 49-yarder, puts the Bulldogs on the board. NFL on CBS tomorrow, league game Denver at Baltimore. Buda thunk the Broncos undefeated at this time. Miami at the Jets, Cleveland, Chicago. Late games, Oakland at San Diego, and it all begins with JB and the gang. The NFL today, tomorrow, 12 noon Eastern time on CBS. Casual conversation between Aaron Hernandez and Tim Tebow on the sidelines. Tebow with a terrific start. Brandon James back to return the kick from Blair Walsh, who planted one 9 yards deep in the end zone to open the game. Low kick. And it rolls right by Brandon James through the end zone and will come out to the 20-yard line. Well, it's time now for our weekly visit from and the Duck asked this week, Georgia's only victory against a number one team was against whom? They're 1-2 all time versus teams ranked number one.
Vern, remember what Alabama did versus Tennessee to stop the misdirection bootleg game? They came with Arenas from the field, blitzed off the edge. Arenas had 13 tackles against Tennessee. I think that's what Willie Martinez needs to do now, is start bringing some edge pressure to force that ball back inside to his defensive tackles and Rennie Curran inside.
See what they've got in mind here. Four down. They don't show a blitz look. And they are not coming. Here's Tebow going left, in trouble for one of the few times in the first half. Let's go to Tim Brando for this Heisman watch presented by Nissan.
Vern, like it or not, this guy's got to be a Heisman candidate. Case Keenum with one of his 5 touchdown passes, this one with 21 ticks left, 28 yards to Patrick Edwards, 559 yards, 5 TD passes. Wow. In games involving other Heisman hopefuls tonight, Jimmy Clausen leads Notre Dame into San Antonio for Washington State, and Colt McCoy and the Horns are set to take on Oklahoma State in Stillwater. Back to you.
Hi, Tim. I think Case Keenum's in the top 5 right now. Absolutely. There's the second drop of the game. No sun on this one. Aaron Hernandez. Well, Gary's been a proponent all along of not casting a Heisman vote until mid-December.
Hold your water on this one, right? Let's see what happens at the end of the year when it really gets to be money time. C.J. Spiller has come from nowhere, hasn't
he? Yes, indeed. Uh-huh. 3rd and 11.
This is where Florida has been giving up sacks. 3rd and long. Remember Arkansas. 3-man rush.
Not much pressure. Here's Tebow. Safety valve to Demps. 1-on-1. And it'll be 4th down. Prince Miller with the tackle. Nick Williams also there. And for only the 19th time this year. Think about that. 7 games in, Chaz Henry's going to come on and punt for the 19th time.
Well, would be even a better record if they weren't turning the ball over inside the 20-yard line.
Well, that's a good point.
It is a great, but it's still a great stat.
I like my stat.
It's a great stat, but I'll give it to Willie Martinez on that last 3rd and long. They played great coverage, zone coverage, and forced it inside.
See if you like this one. They've not given up a yard on punt returns this year.
That's a good one.
Not one, and they still haven't. They're 2nd in the country in punt return yards allowed. There have been only 2 returns against Chaz Henry's punts this year. Number one, Florida Atlantic with -8. Brandon Spikes back on the field, missed only 2 plays. He's been in and out of the lineup the last couple of games. Carlos Dunlap, his teammate, talked to us as part of our Tools to Victory.
Spikes brings a whole nother aspect to the game. I mean, you know what type of player he is. He's a great player. When he's on the field, you know he's going to make his plays, and you always can depend on him. But we've trained this whole year for that. If one man goes down, who's going to step up and fill his shoes?
You can see the difference with and without him. Remember, I think what he most brings to the defense besides his leadership and confidence from everybody, but he has great versatility. He can line up in their base package, move outside, and play defensive end. It really is a challenge for the offenses to try to find where he is.
Charlie Strong told us a couple of weeks ago they have Ryan Stamper, his colleague back there, make all the calls. So Brandon Spikes can just play football. And he does that pretty well. Here's the handoff, and Spikes makes the tackle. I love it when these guys listen.
Let's think Georgia right now, okay? It's 14-3, and I'll tell you, I've been watching Mark Richt work the referees through the whole last timeout. He wants some calls going his way. Mark sometimes, you know, he's the gentleman, the ultimate
right.
gentleman.
Yes, he is.
But he's got his side of it, too. And he got one here, didn't he?
Yep. And a big one.
He was working the officials the whole time out.
Well, Richt, we're told it's on Jermaine Cunningham, number 49.
It's no different. All sports are the same. You
right.
know, basketball, baseball, that's just what you do. You look at the scoreboard. Jermaine Cunningham is the guy who got the call. That's an easy one.
Yep.
Mark didn't even have to work for that one.
First and 10 after the 15-yarder. It's Wayshon Ely. Play fake Joe Cox. Again, he's got a lot of time and a man open. At the 35-yard line, it is A.J. Green. And look at him fight for additional yardage.
This is a pass route crossing 101 play action. This is the first play action pass you put in if you run the ball from I formation. The tight end, first of all, drags shallow across the formation. The other receiver goes deep, and then you drag your big receiver into the middle. That is as nice as you can get it. Nice protection. Georgia is running the ball enough for the play-action game to work.
Contact? Yes. Now, was he induced into the neutral zone?
Well, Ben Jones thought so, and he snapped the ball.
Here's Tom Ritter.
Jay Howard, who stepped across the line, and then very smartly, Ben Jones sees him and snaps the ball to Joe Cox for an easy 5 yards. See, Cox wasn't even ready for it, and Jones actually held the ball there, right?
Yeah, he did.
Because he knew Cox didn't have it. Very heads-up play by Ben Jones.
Sure was. Number 61, the sophomore from Centerville, Alabama. First down and 5. Cox, deep, man open, caught, touchdown, Aaron White, the tight end.
Double coverage on A.J. Green. Opens it up for a linebacker, A.J. Jones, to have to run. Watch the two safeties split. See the two safeties split out? You got a linebacker on a tight end and Joe Cox. We've seen one perfect throw by Tebow and a perfect throw by Joe Cox.
Only the 7th catch of the year for Aaron White. It is his 2nd touchdown catch. And as you look at the touchdown catch, CBS Sports coverage of the Home Depot SEC will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
He dives, stretches out, touchdown.
And look at the entire Georgia offense coming off.
That's the whole team.
I can't believe it. That was 2 years ago. Remember, at least this time, a moment ago, they stayed at the 50. This was after Georgia scored.
Vern, remember Joe Cox told us on the phone. We asked him, does Florida respect you? He paused for 5 seconds and he said, I don't know.
I'm assuming here that they did not involve the crowd.
No, that was
right?
Legal. That's
so
legal.
That's legit.
Well, they stopped that. And we're
I know.
We have to go do golf.
I'm just being the curmudgeon here.
We switched sides. Great players distort defenses, and I'll show you how that happened.
Blair Walsh will kick off. It's 14-10 with 10:40 to go before halftime. Last two possessions have been huge for Georgia. Taken by Brandon James, and take another look at the touchdown toss. Joe Cox to his tight end, Aaron White.
Now it's time for the Jack Link's Beef Jerky Action Cam.
Here's A.J. Green. Watch the safety, Major White, get outside of the numbers to cover up for A.J. Green. That opens that hash up for the tight end. Look at that safety. Outside the numbers, that produces the touchdown. You guys, a quarterback, you know you got that safety running for your star receiver and you got a linebacker matched up, you throw that ball with confidence.
And another flag on the kickoff return, personal foul. Michael Gilliard picked up 15. My goodness. Emmanuel Moody is the running back. Tebow keeps it. Gets to the 38. Let's take a look from the end zone, Gary, at the personal foul called on Gilliard. 55.
Comes out and throws him down on the white.
Yep.
A little too aggressive. Now, just want to point out, remembering back 2 years ago, after that celebration by Georgia, a lot of people don't remember, but Florida went right down the field and scored a touchdown after that celebration.
It's 14-10 with 10 to go, first half. Flag is down, so is Tebow, and he's short of the first down. Now, while we sort out the penalty flag, let's give you the question. To the AFLAC trivia question, Georgia's only victory against a number one team was against whom? 85. Top-ranked Florida, and Georgia won it 24-3. Illegal shift, Florida.
Illegal shift on the offense. Two players moving and not resetting. Five-yard penalty, second down.
Vern, we talked to Willie Martinez, the defensive coordinator for Georgia, and I asked him, what's the biggest difference not having Harvin on the field last year? You know, the big plays, the speed, we understand that. He said last year, we always had to address where he lined up. Every time, we had to find him and call our defense. He said, this year, I don't have to do that. I can call my defense blind.
Now they've got a fullback on the field for the first time. Demp splits out wide to the right. It's empty backfield with five and a corner blitz comes. There's a quick flip out to Deontay Thompson and he put a knee down after he made the catch. Well, let's take you back to that game 24 years ago. Top-ranked Florida team, the Bulldogs came out firing with two huge touchdowns by freshman Keith Hernandez that gave Georgia a 17-3 lead. The offense of Florida stalled by turnovers, missed field goals, and then the Bulldogs put the game away with an 89-yard touchdown run by another freshman, Tim Worley. The upset knocked Florida out of the top spot in the AP poll and ended an 18-game Florida unbeaten streak. That is what Florida is trying to accomplish today.
Vern, Tom Ritter, our head referee, met with both captains, Tebow and the captain of the Georgia defense, and said, guys, it's too chippy out there. Let's settle it down and play football. I think it's a good move by Ritter.
Marcus Doughton, Tebow, third and 16. Blitz, Aaron Hernandez, tight end. Got some room, fights, might have it, does. First down.
Well, I'll tell you, Steve Addazio has taken some heat, but this was a tremendous call. Tight end, kind of tight end jailbreak screen with one of the best athletes in college football, Aaron Hernandez.
Aaron Hernandez out of Bristol, Connecticut. Recruited when his high school coach sent a highlight film down to the University of Florida. Turned down UConn, where an older brother played. First down. Geno Atkins might have moved on this one. Number 56.
Geno Atkins came on strong against Vandy last week. Four solo tackles, four assists. Right on the nose this time of the center.
Dead ball. False start. Offense. 5-yard penalty.
Whoa.
First down.
I thought Geno Atkins moved first, but maybe he was reacting to some movement. He moved on Pouncey's head coming up there. Now, that has been a big conversation point for Steve Addazio as what the center can do. He's looking between his legs, and he raises his head. He talked about that for 15 minutes,
right,
didn't he, a couple weeks
right
ago?
Yep, yep. Demps split wide to the left after the penalty's first down. Here's Demps. Well, here's where the issue became big. Gary, it was at the LSU game on that Saturday night.
Yes, this is when Marquise was turning his head from one side to the other to time it up with the noise. John Chavis, the defensive coordinator for LSU, made a halftime assignment and adjustment, and said when he turns his head, hit him. That took Florida out of their silent count the rest of the game.
The Pouncey twins. Wonderful conversationalists, fun guys to be around. Second down. Tebow play fake. He'll run. Cut down as he gets short of the first down. Was that designed or did he take off?
I think this was him just taking off. He didn't like the coverage. Only a three-man rush here. He did not have the look he wanted, and I think he just said, only these guys, three guys running, let me just find a place to pick up a positive play. The offensive linemen weren't going downfield, so they didn't know he was going to run.
Yep. That's a gain of 12. It sets up a third and three. Riley Cooper, sans helmet. Third and three.
This used to be Tebow's down.
Absolutely. And he'll throw it this time. Maybe. No, he'll run and he'll pick up a first down at the 40-yard line. Remember Matt Jones? Was a wide receiver and a running quarterback, 6'6", basketball player.
Yep.
At Arkansas. Well, with these two runs, Tim Tebow has now passed Matt Jones as the most prolific running quarterback in SEC history.
And after this play, I saw Tebow raise his hand up to Prince Miller and say, nice tackle, help me up. And Prince Miller said, nope, and walked away. get yourself up.
Yeah, Brandon James. Get yourself up, Superman.
Yep. Watch Tim reach up. Prince Miller, good tackle, puts his hand up. Prince Miller shakes his head and said, you're on your own. We're trying to wear you down, Tim.
I think I know the answer, but I'm going to ask the question. Who do you like best in that circumstance?
Well, it's not going to be a fight, I'll tell you that.
No. No, I just mean, you know what
that
I mean.
Is, it is physical. Well,
here's Rainey. Caught and dropped, and a flag is down.
Yeah, this one was inside on Jeff Owens. He turned around right away and said, I got held on this play.
And the officials agree.
Jeff Owens said, I got held.
Holding number 55. Offense, a penalty's declined. Third down.
That'll make it excuse me.
That's right there. I think that's where it is, right there, Vern, inside. He gets into Pouncey, and then gets twisted right at the end of that play.
Well, earlier in this drive, Florida overcame a 3rd and 16 with a pass to Hernandez. Now they're looking at 3rd and 11 and way outside field goal range. Rush from the outside. Tebow steps up off balance as he lets it go. Nelson makes the grab, but he's caught and dropped at the 38-yard line by Brandon Boykin. And that will bring up fourth down.
Well, Boykin did a wonderful job on this one. Tebow gets a little pressure, rides up into the pocket, and has that. I think there's one thing, we'll show you a little later, one thing that Tim really needs to work on if he's going to play at the next level. That kind of dropping the ball below his waist before he throws is very nervous.
Career-long set against Arkansas, 51. This is from 56 yards, and it's got a chance. It's good. That's worth a wow.
Yes.
Two weeks ago, it was 37 yards.
I know. I had a feeling they were going to snap it to Sturgis, and he punted it. What a foot into this one.
The sophomore from nearby St. Augustine, a career best, 56.
Obviously, Mark Richt thought maybe Urban Meyer had something up his sleeves, too, with a punt, because he put Logan Gray, his sure-handed backup quarterback, who's the number two punt returner back there, just in case it was one of those punts, direct snaps to the kicker, but no. I mean, he made this by 10, Vern.
Yes. Well, we were talking about the equanimity with which he met the game-winning field goal against Arkansas. There was no calmness about this one. Second longest in school history. Go back 25 years to 1984, and Chris Perkins nailed one from 60 yards.
The ball's really flying here, isn't it? I mean, it's down to the goal line again.
Yeah. This is Boykin. As we mentioned, he's got two of 100 yards this year. The first against South Carolina and then against Tennessee. And that was a 37-yard return, and Will Hill makes it.
You really have to admire Georgia. They have not taken a half a step back in this football game. They've had a lot of tough things happen to them this year. That Vanderbilt win kind of got them going again, and it looks like the bye week has really rejuvenated them. Started out, remember, 14-0, and they roared back.
Yeah, Florida scored easily on its first two drives. The second one was 92 yards long. Here's Cox. Goes deep. Watch out. Almost picked off. Aerial coverage of the SEC on CBS is provided by DirecTV. Hot day in Jacksonville. Game time temperature was 86.
Vern, Brandon Spikes almost caused an interception here. He shakes off the fullback and gets right into Joe Cox's face, and then smartly doesn't get a penalty.
Cox 6 of 9 for 100. It's 2nd and 10. Caleb King is now the third running back for Georgia. He gets the handoff, and he's got a first down, but there is a flag down.
Caleb King, the ball carrier, flag on the play.
Bring it back.
During the run, holding number 71 offense.
Cordy Glenn was the man who held on the play, the left tackle. It's number 71. Penalty yards, 7 for 69 now.
They're right about on par, what
yeah.
they usually get, aren't
yeah,
they?
Yeah, well, but that's per game.
Yep.
75 yards per game. They're almost there. Israel Troop, number 28, in on offense now, the wide receiver spot. Toss, King. got his fullback out in front. And the tackle made by Ahmad
Caleb
Black.
King on the carry. Knocked down by number 35, Ahmad Black.
Well, if you're going to run the ball up the middle against Florida, you must block number 51. Left side of the screen, and Sean Chappis fits up on him. Hits him once, and then just keeps coming back and staying with it again.
Third and 12.
Joe Cox must be very, very careful here. Punt's not the worst thing.
A.J. Green moves inside. Janoris Jenkins playing to the outside on him. Cox under pressure is sacked by Carlos Dunlap. Dunlap had three at Mississippi State. He now has six for the year.
A great spin move by Dunlap. As you watch Doe break into the backside, you got Spike spying on this play, but Dunlap does a nice spin job inside. Left side of the screen, spins inside against Clint Bowling and makes the play.
Now Drew Butler, leader in the country in punts 49 plus. See if he booms this one. He does. Wow. Backs Brandon James up to the 15-yard line, but he does have a chance for his longest return of the year, a clean block to get him open down the left side. That's a 61-yard punt, 20 on the return. Drew Butler will add to his average. He's the son of Kevin. Interesting guy. At his exit interview, Mark Richt said he asked him, what are your goals for the offseason? He said, I want to get buffed and tanned.
Tim Brando in New York coming up with the GEICO Halftime Report. Spencer, Tony, and I will get you caught up on all of today's action, including Ricky Stanzi of Iowa threw five picks, but two touchdowns in the fourth quarter to rally the Hawkeyes. Iowa remains undefeated by beating Indiana. Back now to Georgia and Florida.
All right, thank you, Tim. 17-10, 25, 26, 7 years ago. The Georgia kicker was Kevin Butler. That's his son, Drew, on the left. And the snapper, that's Butler on the right, I'm sorry. And the snapper was Dr. Mitch Fricks. Well, here we are, 2009. On your left is Ty Fricks, who is a biomedical engineering major. And here's his dad, Dr. Mitch Fricks.
What do you do, buy a whole section of seats around him?
They had a guy named Herschel who played for them. Here's Tebow back.
I really think this is a huge stand for this Georgia defense. They can't give up a late touchdown in this half. Pound offensive line does a good job. Riley Cooper, no pressure at all to the outside. Not very good coverage. Boykin comes up with it, but I think Riley Cooper was down. Tebow steps into this throw. It's not pretty again. That's a tough catch, and that thing's knuckling like that.
That's the fourth catch for Cooper in the ballgame. Two touchdowns, and it's a first down and 10. Down the left side, and the receiver stumbled. Riley Cooper. See if we have holding here defensively. Boykin and Cooper have done battle all afternoon.
Wait, Riley Cooper's turned himself into a real money football player, hasn't he?
I mean,
he's a load. He's big. He's 4'4", 40. He's very tough for these little corners to press. Look at the jersey being grabbed by Boykin. He had to do it, and then he runs up his back.
Pass interference, number two, defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
So physical at the line of scrimmage is Riley Cooper.
Has he, in your mind, been a surprise for this team this year?
Yeah, I think it just took him a couple years to figure out what it takes to play in the high-intensity game at Florida. You go watch practice there. It's a lot of competition, and he had to adjust to it.
First down and 10 after the penalty. Here's Tebow, has it blocked. Knocked down by Brandon Boykin. Well, you made the point about how low Tim Tebow sometimes starts his motion.
Yeah, he has to tighten this up. There's no doubt. Against Arkansas, remember this? Look at that ball below his waist. and that allows Beckett to knock it down. You will not get away with that delivery in the NFL. Ball again below his waist. He's got to keep that at least by his numbers. You can come down a little. You can't come down below your waist and get away with it.
Now Brandon James in motion to the left. Mike Gillisley is on the field. And across the middle, he goes to Hernandez. He gets down to the 23-yard line.
Tim Tebow's pass complete to number 81.
Tackle made by Christian Robinson.
This was a tight end delay all the way. The only ball placed this ball was going to go to was Hernandez. It was a called play. It was going to the tight end delay, and Florida uses one of their three timeouts. That means they got two left.
And the clock stops with 99 seconds to go. Florida leads by 7. They face a third down when we come back. Okay. 99 seconds to go, 17-10 as we near the end of the half. How about last week, the end of the half?
Well, very similar to right now. Florida, if they stick it in the zone, end zone against Mississippi State, it's probably a rout. He throws the pick 6, and all of a sudden Mississippi State goes to halftime with a football game. Georgia needs a stop very badly here.
And Florida would like to get a first down or a touchdown. It's third down and 3, and they're still outside the red zone. Here's Tebow. Cuts up. He's got it, and he's about to break Herschel Walker's record rushing touchdowns. That's number 50. For Tim Tebow, and it comes in the Georgia-Florida game, and he breaks Herschel Walker's record. And he'd like to keep the ball.
I don't blame him. I mean, this guy today is 14 for 18 throwing. It might not always be pretty, but this was a called trap play inside, and he took that ball right up the gut. I don't know if Georgia had an all-out blitz on, but they had nothing in the second layer.
Sturgis, good with the extra point. Remember when he talked with Tracy before the game? He said, how cool would it be to break the record in this game?
Just to be in the same conversation with Herschel Walker is cool, isn't it? Yeah, inside trap play that time, set up by Tebow, and there's no second layer. For Georgia, Willie Martinez must have sold out on the blitz.
Herschel set the record in 3 years, Tim in 4. We'll be right back. Tim Tebow has now rushed for 50 touchdowns in his career. His mom and dad had their first date at this game in 1969. They brought Tim to his first Georgia-Florida game when he was 4 years old. He said he doesn't remember it. They do. Can you imagine the pride they're feeling right now? Tim, the youngest of 5, sister Christy and her husband, missionaries in Bangladesh, watching this game on, what do you call it? Sling vision, right?
Sling box.
See, I'm catching up with you.
I'll be watching it tonight.
And route back home.
Yep.
Taken. Boykin. And another look at the touchdown run from Tim Tebow.
Where were the safeties? The safeties had their men man-to-man. Man-to-man. Watch them vacate as they cover their men. Tebow makes one guy miss, and there's nobody in the center of the field. Perfect call against that defense. See that? Vernon, I mean, he was geared in on Demps.
Right.
He didn't even see Tebow having the ball.
Right. There's something we didn't see last week. First down. Caleb King is the running back. And after Georgia, whoa, watch out, fumble. Recovered by the Bulldogs.
Well, the sack, the last drive for Georgia really gave Florida field position, and this time Joe Cox takes too long. He does, and not even a brush block to the outside. Jermaine Cunningham just comes on a full-out rush that time, and Josh Davis didn't even touch him, not even a brush.
Fifth sack of the year for Jermaine Cunningham, 22nd for Florida, and Florida uses a timeout. After the sack, they're looking at 2nd and 19. We welcome you back to Jacksonville. Coming up, the Geico halftime report. Tim, Tony Barnhart, Spencer Tillman back in the New York studios. We'll get you caught up. We had a special guest here in the booth before the game began. The caveman is here.
Geico caveman.
Yep.
Right now, Georgia needs to figure out a way to get this clock going so they don't have to punt again. Because Florida will burn another one.
Yep.
They're going to have to run the ball here.
They do so with a toss. Wayshon Ely going right, and Florida will call timeout immediately on 3rd down and 17. Brandon Spikes makes the tackle. Well, they haven't called timeout yet.
I think you'll wait to see after this one and call it on 4th down.
Okay.
3rd down and 17.
See, he's thinking maybe I can get an incomplete pass here.
All right.
You block a punt, you just put another 3 on the board. Now you take it.
Okay. And they will do so with 21 seconds.
Good clock management by both sides. Mark Richt knew he had to get out of the half. And Urban Meyer says, I want one more chance with my speed guys to steal some more points before the half ends.
Country Music Week kicks off on the Late Show as Dave welcomes Carrie Underwood. Plus, don't miss Julius Julia Louis-Dreyfus. I should never mess that name up. And catch the Late Late Show with Craig Ferguson, all new on CBS. Here's the snap. Little pressure. Rainey has blocked 2 already this year, and he was close. Here's the run back from Brandon Spikes, Brandon James, and he's down at the 47-yard line. 47-yard punt, 10 on the return.
Now remember, with 7 seconds to go here, Sturgis almost kicked that last one from 66 yards. I mean, he kicked it from 56, but I said it would be good 10 more. Will they try a Hail Mary? Or will they try an unbelievable long kick?
Well,
no, they're just going to take a knee.
Yeah. Sturgis, I bet he's thinking.
Yeah, I'll tell you, another 5 yards, they would go for it. Georgia has nobody deep.
Well, earlier in this quarter, Caleb Sturgis from 56.
And how much is this goodbye?
Ah.
That's good by at least 10 yards. They're going to put time back on the clock here.
10 seconds.
Urban is satisfied, it looks like. He doesn't want a late turnover like last week.
There's the knee, and we have reached, or about to reach, the end of the half. Little jawboning going on at midfield. Halftime. Florida scored on its first 2 possessions. Georgia fought back to make it 14-10. And then the Sturgis field goal followed by the Tebow touchdown have made it 24-10 as we reach the half. And an impressive first half for Tim Tebow. 14 of 18, 2 touchdowns, 152 yards, 8 carries, 63 yards. Let's go down to Tracy, who's with Urban Meyer.
Coach Tim Tebow on that last rushing touchdown breaks Herschel Walker's record. I know you grew up a fan of him. Did you think that you'd be part of this moment?
I'm excited for Tim, but I'm more excited that we got to have football. We got to take care of.
Talk about that last touchdown drive to go into the half up 14.
Well, Coach Dobbs is doing a nice job mixing run and pass, and Tim's throwing the ball well. I mean, we're playing with, that's a good defense. It's real solid inside defense, having trouble moving them. But we're keeping them off balance a little bit. But that's a good defense.
I have to ask you about the 56-yard field goal. Were you in awe? Did you think he could make it?
Well, I wouldn't have called it. I mean, I've seen him do that in practice. He's got a hose for a leg, and he's a great kid, and we thought he could do it. That's why we kicked it.
Thanks,
Thank
Coach.
You.
All right, Tracy, thank you. Tim Tebow scores here. Tim Brando's waiting back in the studio. Let's go back right now.
All right, Vern, coming up on the GEICO Halftime Report, Spencer, Tony, and I will have all of today's action, including unbeaten Iowa trading a trick for a treat with a monster fourth quarter comeback after this word from your local station.